right, so Throne of Eldraine has a Fey Planeswalker. We've got a situation where Garruk shows up and gets enslaved, and Will and Rowan Kenrith turn out to be royalty searching for the High King. Greetings, owners of fine luxury cardboard rectangles. First things first, you may have noticed from my voice that I am indeed still sick. It might have gotten worse. Regardless, there is too much cool stuff going on in the land of Throne of Eldraine spoilers for me not to come before you with these juicy little details that we must discuss. Now, to make sure everybody's on the same page, because I know some people get really, really complainy and wee about this kind of stuff, I am not talking about card spoilers. I am talking about story spoilers. Now, we'll talk a little bit about what this may mean for the cards and mechanically and all that, but just so you know, this is a flavor cruise that we're going on, where we're going to talk about flavorfully the stuff that's going on in Throne of Eldraine and will be represented in cards, but again, I do not have actual cards to show you. So feel free to head down to the comments and be like, you said spoilers, and spoilers can only mean cards. I hope a goat destroys you in the night. I'm glad you're sick. Drown yourself in the bathtub. Because I know there's some people who like to act like that. Now that we've gotten that all out of the way, let us talk about the juicy, juicy details that have emerged from excerpts from the Throne of Eldraine book, which is like Kindred something? I can't remember the name of the book. I'm more caught up on the details. So now we know all three planeswalkers that are going to be in this set. We've got Rowan, Will, and Oko. Let's start out by talking about Rowan and Will. Now, if you didn't know this, Rowan and Will actually share one planeswalker spark. That's an interesting concept because they were born as twins, but yet they only have one planeswalker spark between them. Now, I don't know exactly what we're dealing with timeline-wise here, because admittedly, when you look at the story, it starts out talking about how Will and Rowan are going to be going out on like a tour of the world, essentially, but they're actually seeking the lost High King. Now, I don't know if the book does this thing where we see them in the past and then we see them in the present and a certain amount of time has passed where their father, the High King, is missing. But they're supposed to be this big retinue that travels around. They give some interesting details. They talk about Rowan's best friend and how she rides. She's a proud healer who rides a fine bearded unicorn, which I think is kind of cute. That's a fun concept. But it's weird to me about the Rowan and Will thing, because I don't know if we're going to get the full adult situation. We've seen them already in the Battle Bond set, but the Battle Bond set is a weird set in that we don't know where that set exists in terms of the timeline, right? Like the Battle Bond set is featuring Valor's Reach, which is a massive stadium on the world of Kylum. And that's where all these different individuals come to battle each other. But it's not battles to like the finish where it's like, I will destroy you. It's more battles to, I can beat you severely, but you'll still survive. More gladiatorial sort of champions and showmanship, right? So everybody there has big glowing weapons. And the idea, honestly, of the Kenrith twins being kind of like spoiled royalty that have gone out into the multiverse to find a place to kind of express themselves, something that's different than their home world, all that, where they're just kind of like, well, we lived the pampered royal life, and now we're going to go and we're going to battle in combat together for the masses because we want the adulation and attention. But either way, you've got the Kenrith twins who are royalty with one shared spark. Now that is fairly interesting, but not nearly as interesting as the other information that's been provided. We have a new planeswalker, the third planeswalker, whose name is Oko. or OKO, 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 whatever. It's just OKO is the name. So this is a fairy planeswalker that has thorn and vine magic, so nature magic, also has mental magics as well, but is described as only having a little bit, like a little bit of telepathy. So we'll go into how we find out about Oko and Garruk, because they're actually, they're intertwined with what's going on. And what's happened with Garruk is fairly sad. I mean, if you guys don't know the backstory for Garruk, basically, at the last time we saw him, he was going insane because Liliana had used corrupting magic on him. So Garruk is normally a fully nature-aligned planeswalker, like mono green, right? But Liliana corrupted him into a green-black version, and the corruption was flowing through him. It's basically the antithesis of what he is, and it's driving him mad. So this is the last point that we saw Garruk, where he was basically infused with corrupting necrotic black magics and losing his mind as a result. Now, we flash forward to today's world, the story that we're going to be unfolding going forwards, and that involves Oko, who is not a resident, not sorry, he is not native to Eldraine, because the way that it is described is he is wandering through a pleasant forest. He's a planeswalker who's wandered around to different places. He does know some of the other existent planeswalker individuals. For example, Liliana Vess gets mentioned at one point, and he's shocked by it, which means he knows who Liliana Vess is. So he has a certain level of worldliness. He is not a native of the world, but he's currently visiting Eldraine, wandering through a pleasant forest. It seems like he is most heavily aligned with green magic from what we can see. So he's wandering through this forest, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, you spot him. Shia LaBeouf. No. Oh, I love that music video. Anyways, what happens is Garruk comes bursting out of the forest and attacks Oko, cuts him basically down to the bone with his big axe before Oko can do a thing about it. Oko is basically just kind of like on an idyllic saunter through what he thinks is like a nice forest on a fairy tale world. And all of a sudden, out of the underbrush, Garruk comes barreling out and hacks him with his axe. So Oko's losing his mind. What's going on? Why is Garruk attacking him? Well, Garruk can sense who's a planeswalker. So he's attacking Oko because he's a planeswalker. Now, Oko defends himself with vine magic. So he starts to ensorcel Garruk, surrounding him with all of these thick, powerful vines that are covered in thorns, right? Just kind of traps him in this cage. Now, Garruk is straining at the cage, so it gets made tighter around him. But Oko notices. Oko can feel the influence of the negative dark energies that Liliana has infused into Garruk. And these are so corruptive that the more worked up Garruk gets, the faster the vines around him are withering and having unlife flow through them. They're basically turning brown and withering away. And that is amazing to me, in all honesty, because Garruk is such a nature-aligned planeswalker. So to have that level of black seething corruption in him must be an unendurable nightmare, to the point where it's infusing things outside of his body. So Oko's faced with a real problem here. He's got Garruk, and Oko is just kind of, he's a fae, he's a fairy. So he's kind of glib and playful about what's going on, where he's trying to take the mark of Garruk, and he doesn't know at first that Garruk actually is a planeswalker and can track planeswalkers. So at first, he's just planning to basically leave Garruk wrapped in vines and dip out. Like, boom, I'm just going to planeswalk off to another plane. But then Garruk says something that gives him pause. Garruk tells him that there's no escaping him. You will not escape me wherever you go, even if you go to another world. And that causes Oko to pause. He's like, wait. He's like, first of all, you can tell that I can travel to other worlds. Secondly, you're a planeswalker who can follow me. Well, wait. Well, like, what is it about me that makes you want to destroy me? And Garruk goes, essentially, you're a planeswalker, and that's enough. I have to destroy all planeswalkers. I have to destroy every planeswalker in existence so that I can finally be at peace. And Oko points out, he's like, there's a little bit of a contradiction here, brother. You yourself are a planeswalker. And Garruk just growls at him, essentially. Garruk, at this point, has submerged so much of his personality that he doesn't even know his own name anymore. He can't identify himself. He doesn't want to. It kind of makes me think of, Drizzt Do'Urden? I'm sure some of you must. He kind of was, like, separated away from his people. And the longer he stayed away from his people, the more he became feral and forgot his own name. And so Garruk has forgotten everything, mostly, except for his desire to hunt down and destroy every planeswalker in existence. That's amazing. I don't know if they're going to turn Garruk into a villain over time or whatever, but I was fascinated with what happened to him, and I'm so glad to see that they've brought him back. So, back on track. We've got Garruk wrapped in vines, struggling to break free. The corruption from him is more rapidly taking these vines out. Now, Oko is a cautious sort of fellow. So he says, you know what, I can't be sure this guy can't follow me. The vines aren't going to hold him. I need to do something else. So he resigns himself to using blue magic. He has a smidge of telepathy magic that he can use. Now, from the way that this is described through his character, it makes it sound like he is reluctant to use this magic. What happened to him was this magic was used on him, and he doesn't want to do this to other people unless he has to. But since it seems like Garruk is going to relentlessly chase him down, he feels like he has no choice. So he creates a mind link to Garruk and starts to rummage around in Garruk's brain, and he finds that Garruk is lamenting over the loss of his father. It's like, I don't know if you guys remember the Garruk lore video I did, but what happened to his father was pretty tragic. Now we get another insight into Oko at this point, because he waves caring about your father, he waves that away as a crazy way to be thinking, because all fathers will betray you. So this shows that Oko obviously has some kind of daddy issues, and I think possibly this may tie in to the fact that the High King, the Kenrith twins' father, is missing. And it may turn out that Oko has some kind of complex that has him going around wiping out people's fathers. I don't know if that's going to be the case. I'm not 100% sure about that. Oko could be a number of different colors when it comes to, like, the actual card itself. Oko, it feels very clear to me that Oko is going to be green. There's going to be some blue in the casting cost as well. I wouldn't be surprised to see multiple green mana symbols and one blue mana symbol to represent the telepathy magic. There's the possibility that he may have black essence in him as well, because of the way that things go with all this. But there's also the possibility, because of his conscience and everything, that he could just be green-blue, theoretically with another color put in. But green-blue seems like it's highly likely for Oko. So anyways, back to Oko rummaging through Garruk's mind, going through his memories. Basically, Oko starts to put like an enslavement net into Garruk's mind. Basically, he starts to use his blue magic to layer compulsion into him. Now, Garruk normally would be more able to fight against this sort of thing, but because Garruk has such inner turmoil, he's fighting with himself, he's refusing to remember his own name, it actually allows Oko's magic to be more efficient. That starts to get described. Oko actually says, like, what's happened to you? Like, why are you like this? Who did this to you? And that's when Garruk, through gritted teeth, says Liliana Vess. And that throws Oko for a loop. He goes, whoa, wait, what's going on? Now, Liliana Vess, that shocks him. He is aware of who Liliana Vess is. Now, we don't know what the connection is there. So he basically lays this magic on Garruk's mind initially to learn more about him and to restrain him. Once he has him restrained, that's when Oko has the decision to make. He goes, okay, what do I want to do here? I can't just leave him, really, because I feel like he's going to follow me. Do I want to cut him up into little pieces so I don't have this problem anymore? And so he ponders it, and then he thinks to himself, he's like, well, I did just get ambushed in the forest, and this guy is a huge hulking brute. It would probably be wiser for me to turn him into a guardian for myself. So instead of destroying Garruk, he decides, you know what? I'm going to lay this compulsion on him, take over his mind, and make him into my servant. Now, at first, he goes to ask Aruk his name. But then he goes, well, this sort of asking him his name is going to cause him probably to fight more against the magic. And even says to Garuk, like, Garuk doesn't want to remember his name. And Oku doesn't seem like an evil individual. So he, to a degree, respects that and doesn't want to force Garuk to remember his name. And he also knows that he has an advantage. As long as Garuk is subsuming his personality and his name and everything like that underneath, it actually gives the mind control magic more purchase. So Oko, he is kind of a jerk, he basically goes, okay, I'm going to call you dog, and you can call me master. And at that point, like, Garuk just kind of, like, slumps down and accepts what's going on and says, okay, master, and accepts Oko as his current master. So we have this scenario now, which is so amazing. This is why even though I'm sick, I'm like, I got to come and talk about this. This is so cool. We've got a fairy planeswalker, which is something we haven't seen before. He's most likely heavily green with a smattering of blue, although the way that he thought about hacking up Garuk and is taking him over and, like, doesn't believe fathers are a good thing, it also, all that comes together to make me think he might be black as well. So it might be black, green, blue, like maybe two green, a black, and a blue, something like that. It feels like he's most heavily green to me. Now, I could be wrong. Understand that I'm only going over the fragments of stories that I was able to pull together to talk about this. But the idea of a fairy planeswalker with Garuk as his hound is absolutely amazing flavor, my friends. I am very much looking forward to what's coming down the pike. And on an added note, I am very happy to say that this novel that this is all laid out in seems like it's written in a much better manner than the War of the Spark novel. The War of the Spark novel was awful, and honestly, it made me give up hope for magic lore and stories. This, I've only read about 4 pages of this book, because that's all you can find online right now. That's, like, it's basically, you go to the website where they're selling it, and they've got the, click on it now to read a little excerpt from the book. And it's very, very interesting to me. Just the little bit that I've read has actually whet my appetite for more. The idea of a planeswalker who's enslaved another planeswalker, poor Garuk. First Liliana corrupts him, now he's the slave of Oko. It's just, where do we go from here? Does Garuk get redemption? Does Garuk become evil? Will Garuk continue on his plan to wipe out all planeswalkers? Will I call Garuk Garuk? Never. Never. He will always be Garuk to me. So let me know what you guys think about this crazy, cool, flavorful stuff. A big shout out and thanks to my patrons and channel members. And remember,
and together,
we are the Six Color Magic.